Hi, Emi here, and kia koutou katoa. We'll open with a karakia, so I'll ask everyone to stand, please. Nga mihi o te rā ki te whānau e huihui nei, kia tau te rangimāri e, kia whakatāpua tātou me nā mea, e whakapono ana tātou, haumi e, hui e, tai ki e. Nga mihi nui. Thank you, everyone. And I'd like to acknowledge all the people here today for public forum. I know that there's some items on the agenda that you have a particular interest in, so thank you for making the time and thank you for coming all this way. It's really appreciated. So we'll crack straight into it. Do we have any apologies at this stage? There being none, we'll go straight to public forum. And just so that folks here are aware of the process today, we've got some public forum presentations and then we'll go straight to item 2.1, which is Lindsay Road. So it means that we'll be able to work our way through that and we won't keep people waiting any longer than necessary. So thank you. Public forum, we'll invite John Allam. Are you here, John?
Yes.
Do you want to do the 1 minute thing when you chime?
Yes. So, John, thank you. Just so that you're aware, and I'm sure you are, you've got 5 minutes, and when you've got 1 minute left, I will do that, which is not please take your seats and fasten your seatbelts. All right, the floor is yours. Thank you, John.
I put my food scraps in my own compost bin. I put my papers in my yellow top bin and my glass in the green bucket. You have given me a red bin and a small black bin for food waste. I did not ask for either of these items, and I do not require either of them. And my sole purpose this morning is to ask you if you could tell me, please, when you will take them away.
You have 4.5 minutes left.
I've used all the time I need. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Councillors, any questions of John? John, I have one question for you.
Yes.
You've described your own particular situation, which is fantastic. Thank you. How would you address the situation where people in other parts of the district and in other circumstances have different situations and maybe don't have compost bins and different ways of doing things? How would you address that?
Well, I was interested in a piece in the Herald in the last week in which a man described losing his little black bin and he found it 100 metres down the road where it had been blown by the wind. Obviously, people will have different requirements, but I'm just a little astonished that the council has provided every single household with these items without bothering to ask whether there is a need. I think you might have saved a great deal of money if you had done it that way.
Thank you, John. No other questions from councillors? Much appreciated. Thank you. And we've got a Ngāti Pū representative. Can I just ask who is presenting on behalf of Ngāti Pū? It can be more than one person.
Kia ora koutou. Well, me pala an taku ingo. Ko paka moihau te maunga, ko tikapa te moana, ko ohini muri te awa. Ko Ngāti Pū, me te hapu. I'm here this morning. I'm from Rotorua, and my interest in Ngāti Pū is my grandparents Ngāti Pū. And our whānau is from is based in Whangamata, but I am in Rotorua based, and I'm up here to this morning to tautoko, represent and support the application for a community-based marae in Whangamata. Our whānau has been living on the whenua at Apoli Streets for at least on the banks of the Otahu River for at least over 100 years. And at various times, different members of the whānau have lived there. My koro, our great-grandfather, had a sawmill at the top of the, up on the wires. He had a kauri mill up there. And the whānau used to ride from Hikataya over the hills up to the up to the mill and then down to Whangamata, and that's where we're based. So just from my own point of view, yes, some other members of the family, we are here to give our backing personally for our marae application. Thank you.
Kia ora, Ngā mihi nui. Thank you. Before you go, any questions from councillors? John, Councillor Morrissey.
Thank you for your presentation and for standing in front of us today. I'm going to ask you a question. It is about land over in Whangamata, and anybody else that's going to speak might like to listen to this question. If they know the answer, address it when they do speak. I only became aware last night that under the treaty settlement, there has been a number of parcels of land being returned to iwi under that process. And one of those blocks of land, I believe, is by the golf course over in Whangamata. And I was just wondering if those lands that are being returned under the settlement have been considered as possible sites for a marae. If you know the answer to that, that'd be much appreciated. If you don't, I understand.
No, I don't know the answer to that because, like I said, I've just come up here to lend my support to it. But if there are parcels of land around, you know, and parties could work together on it, I'm sure it'd be much appreciated on both sides of the fence.
No, thank you for your response. And I asked you that question as you were first up, and there will be other speakers that may know the answer to that and may want to address it when they speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Morrissey.
Can I answer that?
Councillor Walker, please.
Yeah, just to answer that, John, the piece of land I think you're talking about is a section on the corner of Achilles, and I think it's Kiwi Road. It was a part of the Department of Health's land, and it's part of a treaty settlement piece. It's a small 800 square metre piece of land and residential area.
Is that the only land that you're aware of that's being returned in the Whangamata area, Terry?
Now, there's another piece down in Patiki Bay, which is a small section on the edge of the coastal marine area. Those are the two pieces I know. The other ones I understand are in a poultry.
Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. We have one more question from Councillor Revel, please.
Thanks for your presentation. It's pretty daunting, I reckon, standing in front of these people. do you stand here representing yourself and your family, or are you representing the entire iwi?
No, I'm here representing my family.
Okay, thank you.
Because at the end of the day, it's my opinion, and that's all I'm basing it on. I'm not here to speak on behalf of others. That's their prerogative.
Yep. Thank you very much.
Thank you. No further questions? Much appreciated. Thank you so much. Okay, next presenter will be Ryan Thompson from the Whangamata Community Marae Group. And Ryan, you've got some people there in support. Kia ora.
We have a couple of speakers.
Okay, so we're going to keep to a 5-minute limit as we've got a lot of public forum today, but you're comfortable with that, Ryan? Thank you.
I feel very privileged again to be able to stand here to kōrero to you all, to have this platform, because I'm just a brother that's on the ground back in Whangamata. To all the whānau that came over today, thank you very much for coming to support our kaupapa. To the Mayor, Mr. Len Salt, and to your councillors, tēnā koe, tēnā koutou. A lot of feelings and emotions coming over the last couple of weeks when it was announced that there was going to be an announcement to be made. You know, the feelings and the emotions of what we go through. It's a real monumental decision for us, because this is for our future. Not only for us that are seated here, but mainly for our young that are coming up. And especially someone like my son, who's 7 years old. And I'd love for him to have the opportunity one day to stand out front of such a beautiful place and say to his friends or say to anyone else, you know, my dad was a part of this, my grandfather was a part of this. What I'd like to speak about first is why we are here and why am I speaking, and I'm here to remind you of our kaupapa. A kaupapa that was started 50 years ago from the founding Kaumatua. And from then we went on to the next group. And after then the next group. And that group was the group, as I said last time, they have sat at their feet. And now it has come to us. There have been many people on the timeline that have been here for the last 50 years to get this kaupapa to where it is right now. We came over here with beautiful day, smiles on our faces. And I really hope that we get to leave again with smiles on our faces. So I'll just keep it really short. And thank you again for letting me stand up here to kōrero to you all. I hand it to Ryan, Mr. Mayor. So, tēnā koe. Kia ora.
O tēnā rā koutou katoa. Mayor Len, councillors, nice to see you all again and happy to be back here. And very much looking forward to hearing a decision today. So I'll try and keep it brief. We presented in detail last time, so I don't want to reiterate any of that, just to address a few key points from the report that was released last week. So first of all, there was some concern raised about how much consultation or community support there was in the report, because that wasn't specific in the business case. So I'd just like to elaborate on that. Over the last 10 years, we have done a lot of community consultation, meeting with groups in the community, public meetings, articles in the paper, engaging with the community board. And all through that process, there's been very, very strong community support for our kaupapa. And so as I stand here today, we have formal support from Mana Whenua through Ngāti Pū and to Urungawira. And in answer to your question, Councillor, although Matua was speaking on behalf of his whānau today, we also do have formal support from Te Runanga or Ngāti Pū, who represent their iwi. As well as that, we have all of the educational institutions in Whangamata, all the health and social services, the Ratepayers Association, and many more community organisations who are supporting our proposal and our business case. But significantly as well, I'll mention that we have a support from the community board, who are elected members elected to represent the Whangamata community, and they voted unanimously in support of our business case. So I think again that speaks to the support that we have in our community. Secondly, there was raised in the report issues around the risk of finding the funding. And yes, we understand there is some risk involved there, but anything worthwhile in life involves risk. The way to mitigate risk is through experience and sound planning. So my question today is, do we have the experience to mitigate that risk? And the answer is absolutely we do. We have two trustees on our Madai Trust who have significant experience in multi-million dollar projects, overseeing, fundraising and building on Madai. We also have Michelle Crook, who has completed numerous multi-million dollar capital raises and brings a wealth of experience to our team. So we do have the skills, the expertise, the experience and the commitment to see this project to completion. Thirdly, the land size. What was recommended in the report is a lot smaller than what the business case recommends, and that was of concern to us, and having enough space for everything that was proposed. We completely understand and support the need to retain some depot land there for the needs of council and services that need to happen there. However, we believe that a better plan can be found than simply cutting it in half and going that side to you, that side to you. And we would like to be able to work in good faith with council and the stakeholders to come up with a plan that can meet the needs of everybody. At the moment, the activities on that site have sprawled out into quite a large area because there's just simply a whole lot of space there. But I think with everyone sitting down together, coming up with a good plan, there could be a solution that suits everybody. And lastly, the time frame. I won't mention much about that, but I think everyone around the table is probably pretty aware that 12 months is a really unrealistic time frame to come up with the amount of money that we need for this project. So we just ask for a time frame in line with what's suggested in the business case. So in closing, I just want to reiterate the significance and the importance of this project to Māori, to the Whangamata community. This will be a significant and historical moment. It's been over 40 years since Kaumātua first founded the Marae Committee. It's been over coming up 10 years since we first engaged with the Community Board. And so we look forward to your decision and hope that we can make history today. Kia ora koutou.
Ryan. You're not getting off the hook that easy.
Yes, sorry.
Ngā mihi nui. Thank you, Ryan. Councillors, any questions? Councillor Connell, please. Sorry, Councillor Connell, can you turn your mic on?
Technology. So, Ryan, I suppose there is a viewpoint that Whangamata is a playground for the rich and famous, but have you got multiple iwi there? And I've read some things about high youth suicide and things like that and levels of deprivation. Can you talk to that just a little bit, please?
Yeah, absolutely. So I agree Whangamata does have this sort of image of a rich playground and in quite a wealthy place, but that's the case, I guess, for a lot of the batch owners there and the holiday makers that come there, but it's certainly not the case on the ground in the community. And the business case showed that really clearly in terms of the demographics and the needs in our community. And certainly through Michelle's experience with the Community Services Trust, you know, really shows that there's a high level of need and support needed in our community. So certainly for everyday families on the ground, things are tough in Whangamata, and this will go a long way to meeting that need and supporting those whānau.
Thank you, Councillor Connell. Councillor Rebel, please.
I've got to have a couple of questions. Firstly, just with regards land size, do you have an idea of what would be the minimum land size you would be wanting?
Yeah, the minimum, as outlined in the business case, was 4,300 metres. That would allow us to fit everything we've proposed on that site with space for car parking and everything that's required. If it were less than that, we'd have to go back to the drawing board and see what to do. But.
Secondly, you mentioned about consultation being very wide with the community, etc., etc. Through this process, has there been any consultation with Ngāti Maru?
There has. We tried around 2018 to consult with a number of Hauraki iwi. We made an invite to meet us and to come to Whangamata and to hear about what we were doing. But we didn't get any significant response to that other than from Ngāti Pū, who we have, you know, had quite a strong relationship with since then. We still, you know, would like to engage with other iwi if they're wanting to support what we're doing. But at this stage, we haven't had luck in getting face-to-face with them.
Mm-hmm. Are you aware that Ngāti Maru are surprised that there hasn't been strong any engagement around this matter?
We were aware through Strength Fawn. He made us aware that there was some surprise at that.
Sure.
So we're working through the process of making contact, and Mayor Len has suggested that he could help us to meet with Ngāti Maru, mm-hmm, through contacts that he has. So we're kind of in progress with that. And like I said, we've tried hard in the past without any luck. But yeah, we are willing to meet with them.
Thank you.
So just to add a little bit more context to that, Councillor Revel, I've had some engagement with Ngāti Maru to ask the question. That door is open and they're ready and willing to have discussions. They were wanting a little bit more information, which was based around the report that's been written. But they are open to discussions, and it hasn't gone any further than that, but the door's open. So, Councillor Connell, please.
Ryan, has your group, I'm sure you have, but I'll ask the question anyway, seen other models where community, sort of multi-iwi marae and community services have worked successfully around the motu?
Yes, absolutely. So great example is just next door in Waihi, and that's very much the model that we're asking for today. They lease their land off Hauraki District Council and have a community marae, which is multi-iwi. So that's the closest example, but there are many other around the country, and it's a common model, and there's some great examples to look at in Auckland, Christchurch and other places.
Thank you. That's a really good question. And is it fair to say that Peter Priest, who works with you, has had some involvement with community marae in the Taranaki area? Is that what I heard from you earlier?
Yeah.
Which I think, from what I understand, has been quite helpful in informing your pathway. Councillors, any other questions? Councillor Walker, please.
Yeah, Ryan, just a question around the supporting community groups and how they will have how the synergies will work with on the site. Can you give us a little bit of a look into that?
Yes, I think that's a real strength of our case is the synergy of those groups and everybody working together. When we started, it was the marae, but as the project grew and interest grew, there were other groups that came on board and supported what we were doing, and having multiple entities sharing spaces, working together so that we can support our community together has huge strength and is better than one entity alone.
Thank you, Ryan. Any further questions from councillors? Okay, there being none, thank you very much. Much appreciated. And we'll move on through the rest of our public forum, and then we'll get to the resolution and the item fairly soon. Okay. Michelle, please. No? Okay, thank you. Our friend Alistair, where are you?
Is he online?
No. Oh, there he is, hiding in the back.
Can I sit down? Okay, sit down.
You absolutely can. Just push the right-hand button. That one there. All right. Thank you, Alistair, and welcome.
Thank you. As you're probably aware, I've drawn the short straw again. I'm speaking on behalf of two groups, so that's all right. The first one is the Continuing Residents and Ratepayers Association, of which I'm a committee member. I want to talk about the new speed limits in Kuatuna and the surrounding area. Basically, we want to say thank you very much to Council for their efforts implementing new speed limits. There's a picture, which I think most of you will have a copy on your file, hopefully, of the new 30K rondelles at the entrance to the village. You can see the Kuatuna sign there. These are fairly recently installed, and it's great. They've been temporary for a while through the summer, and it's been a very busy summer, as you know. It's been a long time aspiration of the community, as Deli, Enrico, and Len will know. And it was great to see it finally happening. It was a very busy Christmas. We had lots of tourists there. It was great. But you get kids walking across the road with their Kuatuna Killer ice cream is about to fall off, and they don't watch the traffic. And people are walking with their phones across the road there. It's a busy part of the village. So it's great to have that 30 kilometers an hour. And it has been respected, and there is a bit of a pedestrian crossing there now, and people do actually slow down and let people walk across. Cars slow down. So it's really working well. So that's great. Because you have a lot of distracted tourists and residents like myself. And also, there's the 30K rondelles past Luke's Kitchen going up the Blackjack as you hit that first bend. And that's really good to see, too. We've been pressing for that for a long time. It's a very dangerous road, as you know. I've had close calls with tourists, speeding tourists coming down there on the gravel road. I was in the Tuna Fire Brigade for over 30 years. We had several call outs there, including quite a serious one with a truck 20 years ago now on that van just above Luke's. So having a 30K zone there is fantastic. We really appreciate that. It's been a long-term goal, so it's great to see it finally happening. It's fantastic. The other thing I want to speak to about is Blackjack Road, the repairs. As you're all probably aware, that suffered very badly in the storm events of a year ago. The major work has been, it's obviously a dead-end road. It's very important to have it open for people of Peter and Otama. They've got no other way out. So it's really good to see the work being done there. Figure two of my attachment there shows the general overview of the work that's being done. What they're doing there is shown better in figure three. I'm a geologist, not a civil engineer, but it's called apparently a mechanically stabilized earth wall, an MSE, and it's benched, which is even better. So I'm not quite sure how it's anchored, but you can see in figure three there the structure. And I think it's fantastic. It's an example, I think a good example of council building back better resilience for the future, because we are going to have more events, storm events, and to have the extra money spent on that is great. I guess some of it comes from Waka Kotahi, but there's a lot of council money in there, so we really do appreciate that, and that's going to be a good long-term solution. It's actually, if I could digress a little bit, it's actually a very interesting area from a geological point of view. Because there were people out there this weekend from Mercury Energy and Auckland University. As you may or may not be aware, it's the site of one of the oldest hot spring areas on the peninsula. It's about 14 million years old. On top of Blackjack, you've got fossil ferns and things, and NASA has been studying those. Grasses and ferns, NASA has been looking at them as an example of extreme temperature environment. And they're looking at extreme temperature environments around the world, basically to look for life, suitable environments for life on other planets. So the Blackjack is a very good example of an area of fossil hot spring activity. Mercury Energy was interested in studying it because you get a very good cross-section through that hill of the different layers. They're not thinking of doing geothermal power, you know, but it's useful for their work down in Taupo to study a fossil system. And if you look in that rock in the back wall there in figure three, if you look carefully, there's actually little fragments of carbonized trees. Trees have been caught up in the eruption 14 million years ago, probably beech trees, and now they're incorporated in that wall. And further down the road, Deli may know this, there's coal, just a bit further down towards Otama, impure coal. It's lots of fossils in there. But of course, for a geologist, impure coal is called blackjack. Oh. And that's where we believe the name came from. The other thing I wanted to mention briefly is, this is not TCDC, but State Highway 25. We've had new speed limits put in there too, 50 kilometers an hour around the village. That's great. I'm sure the Roading Department, Ed Varley, probably had some input with Waka Kotahi on that, so we do appreciate that as well. That's made that whole area quite a bit safer, which is fantastic to see. So that's pretty much my KRA thing. Should I ask the questions for that bit first, or how do you want to do it then?
Yes, please, if you don't mind. So we'll deal with these one at a time. So, councillors, any questions on that specific topic or those topics that Alistair has raised? Councillor Colm, please.
Alistair, you've got those small rondelles. The last conversation I had with your chair, he was talking about more of a gateway signage or something. Is that something you need to talk to Waka Kotahi about?
Well, this will actually be on the TCDC road. That's our TCDC road, I believe, through the village. But yes, certainly we'd like those longer term. But look, this is a great first step. Thanks for that.
Thank you. Any further questions from councillors on that topic? Okay, thank you. Dark Sky.
Okay. So I'm sort of bore you all to see us again with this, but I'm one of the trust members of the Katuna Dark Sky Trust, and we are trying to get the Katuna Peninsula to become what's called a International Dark Sky Community, accredited to the International Dark Sky Association in Tucson, Arizona. I think they call themselves Dark Sky International now. So we've been working on this for a long time. The community has expressed a desire for controls on lightings going back to the 1980s, which I was involved with too. So it's a long-term thing. So it's finally coming to fruition. Also, again, thanks very much to TCDC for their support. Community board, Rick and Deli, you've been bored to tears about this for years, but thank you for your community board support and the council as well. The ordering department, Ed Varley and Bruce Baker with the planning department, they've had a lot of input to this. It's something new for us all, so it's a learning curve for us all, I think. So it's taking probably a bit longer than we'd like anyway. I'm sure you guys would like to. But it's happening. As you may be aware, we've put in a private plan change through our consultants. We have Kaho Environmental doing the planning for us, and it's cost us $50,000 and counting at this stage. It's been a huge expense for us. So it's costing a lot of money, but it costs you guys money too. What we're doing is a plan, going for a private plan change or a variation to the new plan. There's been great community support for the concept, I feel. There's been public meetings at Petuno and Oppido, a lot of support from community board and council. We've had several dark sky events. We had, when Matariki was declared as a public holiday, we had our first Matariki event. We've had another one since then, and we've had one at Oppido. The Matariki ones are very popular, despite happening at 5 a.m. in the morning. We've had well over 60 people there each time to have a telescope viewing and look at Matariki. We do bribe them with sausages and Mars bars and things, but it's great to have community support, so the public behind it. The community board also provided funding for us for some brochures, which have been very useful to get the word out. We drop them all to all the mailboxes, and absolutely great. Pierre's got some as well. The benefits are probably pretty well known, but I'll just briefly touch on a couple of things. We have uniquely dark skies here. I've been doing measurements of the dark skies for quite a few years now with a special light meter. We're as dark as many of the international observatories overseas in Chile and elsewhere. So it's really a treasure we need to preserve. Benefits are all already being recognized internationally for our dark skies. As some of you may know, the European Space Agency has installed a telescope. It was originally going to be with us at Stargazers, but our internet's crappy, so we put it at Oppido. It's a European Space Agency telescope. It's looking every night. It watches for space junk, which affects space stations and things, and also looks for meteorites, hazardous meteorites, which could potentially impact the Earth at some stage. So that's been really useful. I recently visited one site in Australia. There's only three sites in Australia that have these. Two of them are one site at Mount Stromlo, but we've got one of them in New Zealand now, which is fantastic, acknowledgement of our dark skies. Recently, at Stargazers, where I operate from, we have installed a new meteor camera, again, part of a global network. It watches the sky every night, analyzes about 800,000 images every night, looking for potentially hazardous meteorites and comets as well. Again, these sort of things are only possible when there's a good dark sky, which is what we've got where we are. So we do want to preserve that. So it's been very useful. As I mentioned, we're putting this plan change through to get new lighting regulations. We've been advised it could cost up to $15,000 for the plan change, and we haven't got any money. But I want to stress that we'd like this legislation to be fairly easily adaptable for the future, because going forward, we like to involve not just the Petuno area, but also the wider Coromandel. And we've had approaches already from other communities in the Coromandel asking about how we do it and what it involves and that sort of thing. So the Petuno Peninsula is just stage one. We see it as stage one. Stage two will be possibly Hong Kong up the peninsula. As you may be aware, there's talk of one on Great Mercury Island. Michael Fay is doing things out there. That's a separate issue. And eventually, the whole peninsula, this is years down the track, and the aspiration for New Zealand is to become the first dark sky country in the world, and that's much longer term view. So the legislation is for a plan change, or I think it's called a plan change. So the final goal of the dark sky in New Zealand. The benefits also are great for tourism, because there's something that works all year round. It's not just summertime activity, it's all year round. Also, it's nighttime. There's not a heck of a lot to do at night, especially in Petuno, apart from loops, I guess. But nighttime activity take place. And also at wintertime, the skies are often better in the wintertime. There's longer skies, dark skies. There's actually in many ways more to see. So we just think it's a good idea. So thank you to council for their support.
Thank you.
And we're happy to answer any questions.
Councillor Connell, please.
Have totally supported this plan change all the way through. And I was just sitting here thinking, have you engaged, you're talking about Whangapoa as well, with Ngāti Hei and Ngāti Huarere, in terms of, celestial navigation being so important to Māori whakapapa and history, and the opportunities there to engage and create even work opportunities for iwi?
Sure, that's right. We've had Joe Davies out at doing our tours and things and talk about navigation. So we have a special equipment there for navigation. It's a very important part of it, which we talk about quite a bit. It's an ongoing thing, and it's a great inspiration for kids as well. Things you can do, with navigation, and that's part of the input for the tourism side of it as well.
Thank you, Councillor Connell. Any further questions? Alistair, thank you once again. Always really informative, and I know this council is really keen to see the Dark Sky project keep moving forward.
I'd just like to stress again that it's going to be an expanding thing, so any legislation should be able to be adapted fairly easily and cheaply.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right, appreciate it. So that's the end of our public forum. So could I get a mover and a seconder, please, from councillors? Councillor Rodley, Councillor Connell, those in favour? Thank you. Before we move to item 2.1, items not on the agenda, we need to include a late item, which is the glasses on. Totara Valley Road as a late item added to the agenda. Discussions on this were still taking place right up to the last minute, so this needs to be included. This time sensitive. Could I get a mover and a seconder, please? Actually, I'll move it from the floor, and a seconder, Robin. All those in favour?
Aye.
Thank you. That's carried. Any conflicts of interest to declare? There being none, we'll move to item 2.1. Thank you. So, Whangamata, we're going to invite John Muston, our property manager.
Through the chair, Donna.
And Donna, are you here, Donna? Yes, Donna. Welcome, John.
Kia ora, your worship.
Hi, councillors.
Welcome, Donna. Thank you. So what we'll do is we'll take the report as read, if that's all right, and hand it over to John and Donna to add anything further that needs to be added. And I know there's been some work done on this, the resolution wording and the process to make sure that we've got the most robust and the best fit for purpose resolutions in front of councillors. And I'll hand it over to John to give us a summary, please.
Thank you, Your Worship. Councillors, 101 Lindsay Road won't be sort of a surprise to anybody. It's sort of been an item that's been on the books for a while now in one form or another. So the latest consideration is around what do we do with the site? And in conjunction with that, and very much intertwined with it, has been the proposal and consideration of the community marae and wellbeing hub by the locals in the community. So my report gives you a little bit of a background on the history of the property, some of its limitations. It then addresses the strengths and weaknesses and the business case there. Bear in mind that is, there's a matter of opinion when you consider things like that. And there are going to be other opinions and other options that might come out of dialogue. I think, Your Worship, I'll just leave that there and probably engage through questions and debate.
Thank you, John. Donna, anything to add to that at this stage?
Through the chair, no, not at this stage. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So what we'll do is we have item one, which receives the report. I'm going to get a mover and a seconder, please, to receive the report. And item two, which is thanking the Lindsay Road Working Group for its business case submission. We'll deal with those two items, one and two, and then I'll open this for discussion, please. So can I get a mover and a seconder, please, for items one and two, receive the report and thank the group.
Through the chair, Martin.
Councillor Rodley and Councillor Walker, please. All those in favour?
Aye.
Thank you. Okay, I will open this for discussion for councillors. We'll have a general discussion on the report. We can ask John and Donna any questions. When we get to the resolution, there has been some work that the staff have been doing behind the scenes to try and get some clarity around the wording of the resolution so that what is in front of councillors solves some of the, or addresses some of the questions and issues that have come up. And we will address these as we go through. So we'll start with Councillor Morrissey and then Councillor Gary Percival, please.
Just a couple of quick questions, John, regarding your report. I know you've put a lot of work into this, both years. If it was decided that we were going to split the land and use, retain half as depot and the other is for community use, that would result in a reduction of the $25,000 a year that we currently get from the depot being leased as an entire area.
If the depot lease really more pertains to the structure than the grounds, so and any proposal that retains a portion of the depot for that use, that $25,000 would be retained.
Okay, so we wouldn't lose any money through leasing. The other thing is, John, the difference between district land and land that wards have purchased individually. There are a number of instances of that in Coromandel, I believe in Thames and Whitianga. Are you aware of any instances in the entire district where district land has been given to the community for a community purpose? I'm trying to say there are a number of parcels of land that community boards have purchased and then allowed community facilities on them. Are you aware of any in the district as a whole where that's occurred?
One that springs to mind is the land that was made available to the Coromandel Independent Living Trust in Pound Street, Coromandel.
Yeah, I'm aware of that one. The difference, that's what I'm trying to get at, John, is that was paid for through local rates. That whole sports area was locally rated and that was part of that land, so it was a local rate. It wasn't paid for by the land wasn't bought by the district.
Can I just point of clarification here, Councillor Morrissey? There is no resolution on the table in front of council for land to be given to a community group. It is a reallocation of purpose and the discussion of a lease for community purposes. So there's no proposal on the table for land to be given to a community group. Land would be retained by council and leased to a community group. Are okay. We clear on that?
I actually, it's a very fine point that, Your Worship. So if we are talking about what is currently a commercial piece of property, would we be getting a commercial rent from the part that we'd retained?
So that's a separate issue. And when we are, as a council, making decisions about the use of council land for community purposes, then this item is no different from the 71, Donna, can you help me with the numbers? The 71 or 70 other pieces of council land that are leased to community groups for community purposes. So it's a common, and John, you can probably help me out, it's a common use of council land for that land to be leased to community groups for community purposes. This is, fits in Coromandel Independent Living Trust, I'm guessing.
Your Worship, Council, yes, there are 71 community-type organisations leasing council land across the district, typically the $350 in terms of that rate. A substantial number of that 71 are actually on reserve lands. We have very few fee simple parcels of dirt anywhere in the district.
Thank you. Rika.
Sorry, thank you. I just wanted to request that we have the new resolution up on the screen. I didn't see that email until I got to Tim's this morning. I just want to make sure that we're all clear about what we're looking at and deciding on, if that's possible, thank please.
And Ari.
Yep, through the chair, we will put that up on the screen.
Done some work on that, I think. So that should be just about ready to go. Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
So who do we have next? Councillor Walker, and then Councillor Gottlieb, and then Councillor Connell, please.
Yes, thank you. Good morning, John and Donna. John, when I read the your report, I was a little concerned that the business case that had been put through by Veris, which was stress tested, was pretty solid. Did you feel that that was a good business case that was provided to the council for viewing?
In my report, through your worship, I refer to the case as being a good case. Yes, yeah, they've done some very good work, some very good background material.
Right. Mm. Okay, so within that, there was a clause in there or an area in there where they talked about funding and the periods of time it takes to put a, something like this project together. I think it was in months, something up to 60 months. When we spoke to Kilt, Mike Nguyen, he was saying that at least a year or so to get organised and 3.5 years of funding was required to get that project together. Do you agree that this does take some time, especially in the current market, for getting these projects together?
Councillor Walker, can I just interrupt there and just let you know, which you might not be in the loop on this, right up to the last minute, staff have been working on a revised resolution which removes that
yeah,
12
right.
months and adds in some flexibility for both councils and the community group to work through that process.
Right, yep.
So it's removed that issue, yeah. Requirement, okay. Which I think is going to be helpful all the way through. So I wonder now whether it might be helpful for councillors to take a look at the revised word or proposed revised wording of the resolution. The objective behind this revised wording is two things. First of all, there was a degree of concern that councillors were having put in front of them some detailed stuff which needed more work between council and the community group to go through the requirements that the group had or might have and the council requirements that we had as well. So the idea is to allow councillors to have something in front of them which approves the staff and community group to work together to come up with a solution rather than council being asked to make decisions on very fine details on the fly today. It allows that time, but it also gives some clear direction on the purpose of the land and the use of the land. Is that helpful?
Just with respect, I thought we were going to hear from Councillor Gottlieb, just in terms of general discussion.
We are, but what I was concerned to do was make sure that councillors were aware of the revised wording of the resolution so that when councillors are speaking to it, they are aware that the original proposed resolution has had some minor changes made, but they are important changes. So, Councillor Gottlieb, are you happy to talk to that based on the
yes, well, I'm happy to move the proposed change with Donna sent us yesterday evening. I just want to give a little bit of background. You might have seen I've emailed you something with a history. In 2001, I represented Beverly Williamson, the daughter of the Williamsons, over the Williamson Park thing. But in the course of that, I was contacted by TCDC and their then lawyers, Miller Polgrain, saying there's a bit of land which was going to be used for a fire station. It's not happening now. We'd like to be able to give it back. We didn't know who to give it to. And they actually, Bill Butler, who's the lawyer dealing with the survivors from Gallat Iverson, said, yes, we did the dealing with them and it cost, we didn't even charge the family, Beverly, to get the land back. What you can see is the survivors, and I'll just explain because I spoke again yesterday and got it to
Joanne Beamish-White. Hi, Gary. My mother, Sylvia Beamish-White, is Philip and Madeline's niece. My grandmother, Rita, was Madeline's sister. Mum and Beverly Williamson grew up together as sisters. Sylvia and Joanne streets are named after us. Mum is still alive. I'm caring for her full-time in Rotorua. They are fully supportive of what is being proposed. They want it to remain in the community. They don't. They just want it to remain with the community. And that's what the family survivors wish to have. So I think it's nice to know that they are fully supportive. They've seen the plans. They've seen them from as they've changed. And they just want it to happen. So I just thought I'd let you know.
Thank you, Councillor Gottlieb. That's much appreciated. Councillor Gary Percival, please. Oh, sorry, Councillor Connell, my mistake.
I would just like to speak in total support of the proposal. I don't see it any different to the Tairua Skate Park, and a group of passionate, committed people who have put so much effort into their community for so long that if it's not this piece of land, then where is it? I think if our clause enables the community group to work together with the current people who are leasing the other half to find the, you know, you've got to look at access ways and driveway crossings and parking and all sorts of things like that. I don't want to see you guys locked into something that isn't workable. I think it's an amazing opportunity to have something close to town. You've got a skate park down the road. Otherwise, and it's a bit like Whitianga, things that are community focused get pushed further and further out of town, and accessibility becomes a problem. So I'd like to express my full support for what the Whangamata Working Group is proposing.
Thank you, Councillor Cole. Councillor Robley, please.
Yes, so just looking at on our agenda, it's 4B, but it looks there that it's 5B on the new one. I just wanted to check about the, it's talking about taking an area of 3412 square metres and changing that from its current designation to a local purpose reserve. But it's a bigger, the area itself is bigger than that, so would part of that site be declared a reserve, or would the whole site be declared a reserve? Can it still be a reserve and have a depot on it?
Your Worship, there's two options here. One is, so the land is held for the public work, and you don't want to say it's surplus for that purpose, because you're going to have them trigger the disposal mechanism, which you have no choice on. But to make, you've got two choices. They are, one is you declare the whole parcel from depot to reserve, so it would become a local purpose depot, community buildings, whatever, reserve, and then you could grant leases for the purpose that's been intended. Or secondly, you can divide the parcel up into portions, and what was sort of suggested was two portions, and declare one of those portions as a reserve. We need to declare it a reserve. It's the only way we can grant a lease to the organisation. So in terms of the area that's there, so we've heard this morning through the forum that area 3412 is too small. Their proposal actually talked about 5,200, and they acknowledge also that there needs, until you get down to design elements to work out where your buildings are going to be situated and how will your vehicle movements be around the site, you know, that's going to evolve a little bit, and that will help give definition to the area as well.
So can I just follow up question? So would it actually make more sense and save expense or time later on just to make the whole parcel of land a reserve? Or am I missing something?
Through you, Your Worship, yes, you could do that. My advice to the council would be to do it into two parcels. Why? It's because you're preserving a different option some date in the future. If you wanted to deal with the bit that's currently the depot, you can. As soon as you've made it all one, then you're constraining that option for the future.
Okay. I don't really understand.
Yeah. Okay. Councillor Revel, please, and then Councillor Sinclair. Sure.
John, thank you for your report. And I was interested to see and understand the potential economic benefit of declaring the land as surplus to requirements. And I'd have to say that economically it looks very attractive. So in my mind, I'm sort of weighing up between something that looks very economically attractive versus something which would potentially enhance the community. That's the trade-off we're doing. And where I'm at the moment is I would not want to go down the dead end street of declaring the land surplus, because as soon as we do that, we lose all sorts of other options. So that's kind of where I'm landing with that. In the report, in your report on page 148, it mentions, talks about the resolution that came from the community board, and I found it a little bit ambiguous, and I'm just wondering whether the community board could clarify for me that the statement where it says that the recommendation supports the business case to be provided to the council. And I wasn't sure, is that supporting it being provided to the council, or is it actually a full support of the business case? And can you have some nuance around the community board on that, please?
Can I answer that?
As someone who sits on the community board, yes, I think that's appropriate.
Yes, the community board was tasked with meeting a resolution, and the resolution was a council resolution to provide a business case to the council by the December 2023. So the business case came before the community board and they endorsed it, but they endorsed it because the council was part of the resolution to provide it to them. So that was the explanation, that they endorsed the community, the business plan, but also that it had to go to council for sign-off. They couldn't have, didn't have the mandate to sign it off.
Right. So just for clarity, there's full support from the community board for the business plan as being received by council.
Correct.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Morrissey, then Councillor Sinclair, and then Councillor Rodley, did you have another question?
Thank you. Thank you, Your Worship. Splitting that lot into two, John, did I hear you correctly before when you said that you understood the situation was that the 3,412 metres proposed for the community marae would be insufficient for them, they needed a little more, or is that, did I mishear you?
In the proposal, they say that the desired area is 3,412, but they also say we need some extra land for vehicular movements to meet car parking requirements, ingress, egress. It comes back to when the design's done, you'll know better what we all need to do.
Okay. Well, it's sort of hard to make a decision without knowing precisely what areas of land we're talking about. I mean, to be honest with you, I'm softening a little, maybe, but I need to know what I'm dealing with, you know. You guys will understand, I never ever want to give away the land and I'll never sell it. But yeah, I am softening towards the splitting into two, but I want to know what those two comprise of. I wanted a viable depot, because we need one in Whangmatar. When are we going to know the answer to that? John, what is it likely to be, do you know?
Well, that, with the amended resolutions, Your Worship, that will come out of the dialogue. But based on the 5,200 they promoted as being sufficient in total, give or take, that would have the impact of us losing the bit that's occupied by parks at the moment to the rear of the site.
Yeah, can't happen.
Probably have the impact of the next big shed where we store the generator would probably be lost in terms of its current location. It's not to say you couldn't pick it up and try and move it or something, but that's going to incur some more cost.
So the intention of the amended resolutions was to allow some flexibility for council and the group to work together to find the optimum spaces. What I guess I'm hearing from councillors, and I'm concerned about slightly as well, is that whatever resolution we land on today does not lock us in to defined areas which then remove that flexibility. So what we need as a council from you, John, and from you, Donna, is assurance that whatever we're voting on allows that flexibility for that dialogue and those negotiations to continue and does not shut either council out of what we need or the community group out of what they need. So the wording of the resolution, where we've got 3412 square metres, is that appropriate wording, or does that need to be looked at to retain that flexibility?
Your Worship, there's two choices here. We can either, just as the definition of the survey office plan is not defined because that survey hasn't taken place,
okay,
likewise we could remove from that resolution the reference to 3412 and just leave that open.
Yeah.
The other option is to take out those resolutions that request the Minister completely right now, because there's going to be another round of dialogue now with the, if the resolutions on the table are accepted, with the organisation, and that will inform what that area will be. The resolution, when it would come back, it would come back exactly the same as it is there, except the area would be more definite.
Okay. So I'm going to carry on around with the questions, but I'm hoping that helps me with a better understanding. I'm hoping that helps councillors to get a better understanding of what's in front of us.
Yeah.
So that
was my exact point in terms of the resolutions. I was very happy to receive your email, Donna, last night, because it gave me a lot more clarity about that 12-month funding, because the last thing we want to do is set up the project to fail because we've given them an impossible hurdle that's too hard to jump over. And the mood around the table is most definitely not to sell it. So it would be really nice to know that you are all in a dialogue together so that we could actually make this work while everybody's happy, which is exactly why I was going to raise that resolution 5B in terms of having that area there, and does that make it too restrictive? But I think we've just canvassed that. So I would be absolutely, yes, it's now crossed out on the screen. I'd be really happy to have it removed because, as you say, John, it's going to come back to us anyway because the dialogue is going to continue. So thanks, Len.
So what we're going to do, I'll go to Donna, and then Aileen has a suggestion which might, I think, steer us through this and allow that flexibility. So Donna, then Aileen, and then we'll come back to Martin and Rekha, please.
Thank you, Your Worship. Through the Chair, the reason why we left B, C and D in there, which is quite okay to take it out, is that it sort of also gives, it allows staff to actually start the process of getting the land into reserve, which is, it's a bit of a process to do, and I think it also sends a commitment to the group that, you know, that we are actually going to do that, because once we've turned it into reserve, that's what it becomes. But yeah, either way is fine. But that was the reason why we decided to leave them in there.
Thank you, Donna. Aileen, please.
Okay. I always say you shouldn't make up resolutions on the fly, but here we go. So I'm just going to make a slight change to A, which is something along the lines of directing staff to enter negotiations to determine a solution that provides for a viable depot and a viable community marae, and commences the relevant processes to turn the land into reserve.
Can I get that? So what we'll do is we'll take 2 minutes to get those up on the table, please. While that is being done, we've got Martin. Have you asked your question? Martin, then Rekha, and then Deli, please.
My earlier questions have been answered, and as much as I also am not keen on resolutions on the fly, that actually seems like a good resolution. And various people have stated their preferences. I would not be in support of selling it or disposing of it. They're not making any new land, so we need to keep it. And I would also like to give the working group more time to work with council to be able to resolve the depot and the community marae. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Rodley. Rekha, please.
Thank you. I just also wanted to see if there were any further resolutions that we couldn't see down the bottom of the page. No? Were there any further resolutions that we couldn't see.
Oh, through the chair, those were the ones that were in the agenda when it was distributed.
Right, so it's just all moved out. Okay, thank you. That clarifies. Yeah, and my comments are very similar to Martin's in that I would not be in favour of selling or disposing of this land, and very supportive of giving the working group time to work with council to find a viable solution in terms of space.
Thank you.
For a long-term lease, not giving land away.
Thank you, Councillor. Deli, please.
Probably a question for Donna. So if we pass this today and there's still that negotiation around the actual dimensions of the site for the community marae, can we immediately give the working group some kind of documentation to say that they have secured the land, they're only working on the size of it, because I understand that raising funds, you need something that says, I've got the land in the pocket so I can start looking for the funding straight away, because I understand those processes can take a very long time.
Through the chair, John, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think resolution on my pack, resolution 4 does that, but it's resolution 5, I think, where it says resolves to support the 101 Lindsay Road Working Group proposal. That would be, that's a resolution. Well, that is a resolution that council has made.
Thank you. Councillor Sinclair and then Councillor Morrissey, please.
Yes, my question has actually been asked, but to follow on from Dally's point, is it worth putting a resolution in that says we categorically, is that sufficient enough for them to have this, the required support that they need, the mandate to go out to the funders? Or do we need a resolution that says we're absolutely not going to sell the land?
I'm getting a governance advisor in my ear saying it absolutely is sufficient. I'm comfortable with that. Councillor Morrissey, please.
Yeah, just going back to the time to raise the funds. And I totally agree, 12 months was insufficient. It needs to be longer than that. Although that's all Kilt was given to get there. First peg in the ground, otherwise, yes, they were going to lose that. But I think there should be some time limit there. I'm sure that this group is going to be able to raise the money. I have every confidence they will. But in the event they can't, and within a, say, a four-year period, I think that would be more than enough time frame, and that would be a bit of a safeguard for council as well. So I do think there needs to be some sort of time emphasised for this group to get themselves up and running, and I'm happy with whatever that time is, but there should be a time.
Thank you, Councillor. Just before we come to you, Councillor Walker, I'm going to leave that on the table for the moment, because I think it probably needs a bit more thought and discussion. Councillor Walker, please, and then Councillor Grant.
Yes, I just like a quick talk about the funding. These projects are big, very big, and the current market is very difficult at the moment. After COVID, the large organisations haven't got the money to spread around they did pre that. In the business case, they talk about a time period of 60 months, and I spoke very strong or long time with Mike Noon at Coromandel, and he said, you need time. These things aren't easy. So I'd be reluctant to leave a time frame in there to kind of sort of sets it up to fail as other, rather than set it up to succeed. So I think if we just leave it open the door and give these people the amount of energy and time they're going to put into this without going to the ratepayers is an opportunity that we should embrace.
Yeah, I'd just like to say I'm not concerned about the length of time. If it's 4 years, 5 years, Terry, but there does need to be a time on it. And I would like to see that eventually end up in the resolution.
Thank you. Councillor Grant, please.
Thanks very much. And I'd like to start off by saying how impressed I have been with the presentation of the business case and all of the background information. I'm very supportive of what is being put forward here. And I also agree with the sentiment that's been expressed in regard to how I believe it should be structured in regard to the arrangements. I'm also, Terry, very aware that this has been through the community board, and that is also an influence on my thinking as well. But I'm also very supportive of the messages that Councillor Morrissey has made in regard to the need for a time frame to be put in for this. So certainly don't want to set any anything within the arrangements that will put anything that will make the funding arrangements difficult. But I think there needs to be a review point at some stage where we look to see how progress is going at a council level.
Thank you, Councillor Grant. In the original business case, there was a timeline in there. And I'm wondering whether councillors might consider the original proposed time appropriate. And I'm just looking for it.
2029, I think it was.
Page
2029. I think the time frame was through to 2029.
6 years. And that's from the business case?
Yeah.
Okay.
6 months, isn't it? But starting a year after the agreement to get the funding on the place. 5 years.
Thank you. Donna? Donna?
Could I make a suggestion that part of the resolution that I wrote last night about, you know, engaging with the group and coming back and looking at those viable options, one of those viable options really is the timing as well. Mm-hmm. Instead, you know, my recommendation, instead of making a resolution on the timing today, is that the resolution that you have up here actually allows staff to go away, engage with the group, and then come back with some reasonable timings to you when they come back with the other options.
I think that's a very sound proposal. The only question would be whether in the revised proposal under A, direct staff to enter negotiations, whether we include some wording about the length of time available for fundraising, whether that's included in that resolution A, without defining what that time is, but directing staff to negotiate with the group on the length of timing for that fundraising, which would perhaps alleviate some of the concerns of councillors. It might be overkill, or it might be just an accepted thing that's going to happen anyway as part of the good faith negotiations, but it would be possible to put it into that wording of resolution A. No. Councillor Sinclair and then Councillor Walker, please.
I wonder if a way around this is that the previous item B there had a report back to council with viable options, which is missing from current A. Oh, no, it does. Sorry. Does it say that? No, it doesn't say that. So I wonder if that's the time to discuss that, because at the moment all we're doing is we're saying we're really supportive. You guys have the direction to go out and talk to our staff and start the fundraising. So I wonder if that's the point at which we need to talk about a time frame, because at the moment we don't have an agreement about how much land. So, you know, I really feel like we're missing the step of reporting back to council with the determined solution. Because I'm really uncomfortable with the idea of putting a time frame on this, because we just don't know what's going to be happening in the external funding world.
Yeah.
So I hear you, John. Absolutely do. But at, you know, at the moment, it looks like the solution which we really wanted, which was for a viable depot and a viable Marae, is on the table. It looks like it's going to go forward. I don't see why we need to put in a funding thing, because everybody's going to get their bite of the cherry the way it's written. Yeah. So the only thing we need is a report back to council and resolution A.
So the proposal is that we reinstate B with slightly revised wording. So we keep A.
Keep A.
We go back to B and do some request staff to engage with the working group, report back to council, that's the key, with viable options on for the lease and funding. Donna?
Sorry, through the chair, John has just brought up a very good point. If you look at the new 5A, that is the way that's written at the moment is that you'll be turning the whole lot, the whole parcel into a reserve, because it says to process to turn land into reserves, which isn't, if you were still wanting to go with the split decision, that 5A would need to be amended. Also, if you are still proposing to go with the split decision, I would recommend that you still bring in the C, D and other ones.
But
as well.
Without the specific areas of land identified?
But without the specific areas of land, so it gives that flexibility.
Yep. So from where I sit, to be really clear, I want council to retain the ability to do what council needs to do and to retain the ability for us to work with the community group so that council's needs are met and the community group's needs are met, and where we land on those is a negotiated thing. So if we lock ourselves out of that ability under the wording of Resolution A, that concerns me. So how do we get around that, John? Do we amend the wording on A and bring back in C, D and E? What's the best way through that?
Just delete that line for now.
Okay, can
we still legal them, we're just not being commencing the process to actually change the interest.
Okay.
And once we've had the dialogue and
John, sorry, can you put your mic on? Because we've got people online that need to be able to
Once we've had more dialogue and we're getting closer to definition of what the parcel sizes would look like, mm-hmm. it's then that we are starting to have it formally surveyed and then can commence the statutory processes to give effect to that.
Okay.
And when we do come to do that, we will need a resolution of the council to make that request to the Minister of Lands.
Okay, which we can do.
Yes.
What we've done is we've set a direction. And absolutely. We've set a direction which allows council to move forward, which gives the community group a clear direction about what council's intention is. But it means that we've not locked ourselves out of options. So, Councillor Sinclair, did you have another question? No, okay. Councillor Walker and then Councillor Rebel, please. Yeah.
Yes, just going back to the funding option, and I agree with Councillor Sinclair that these discussions can happen with the group. Often going through a major funding round can take a year just to do one of them. So if you miss out on something like that and you're into another year, it can prolong the funding model if you are continually looking for big money. So I think those discussions will happen with the group as we form the relationship over the land and over the site. As it develops to find exactly how much they do need to get.
Thank you, Councillor Walker. I just point out that part of the land involved with the BMX track has been sitting unused for 10 years. It's just sitting there empty. So what's being proposed is going to revitalise that whole area and turn it into something fabulous. So,
yeah.
Councillor Rebel, please.
Thank you. Look, I'd like to declare that I'm a self-confessed optimist. I've supported New Zealand cricket ever since I knew the cricket existed. And I absolutely support this from an optimistic point of view. I do have some disquiet, which I just want to, before we vote, I am concerned that there has not been effective consultation with Ngāti Maru. I'm concerned that it's kind of slightly out of town. I'm concerned that it's a huge amount of money that needs to be raised to make this effective. And I would just want to be careful that for us as a council in supporting this resolution, that it doesn't be construed or set a precedent that that council is doing anything other than making land available to a community group. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Thank you, Councillor Revel.
And I promise I won't say anything else.
I'm going to go to Councillor Morrissey, and then I'm going to put the resolution, and I'll start with five.
Yep, thanks, Ian. And I know I've had a fair bite of the apple, but I support everything you just said, actually, Peter. I do have concerns. There's no two ways about it, but am supportive of the project. John, the depot that we have there, it's only using around about the amount of land that is proposed to give them. Are they going to, you've had discussions with them, John? Can they operate in the smaller area?
Yes, there has been some discussions, not in any great detail, but when you walk around the site, you know, there's a lot of old clutter and old little lean-tos and all sorts of things. You know, the place, better use of the space could be made.
Okay, so, yep, that's my only concern, because I don't want to lose that depot there. We need an operating piece of land for these contractors. Thanks, and I'll say no more, Ian.
Thank you. So I'm now going to... sure, Councillor Gottlieb, and then...
Do we need to spell out that we're not proposing to say we should not require the land, we need to sell it? We need to say we are retaining the land for purposes.
So, Your Worship, at the moment the land is held for a depot until such time as it's not required for that purpose. There's no need for any other resolutions.
So,
I'm happy to move the resolution.
Thank you, Councillor Gottlieb. So we're looking at item five, and I'm going to do these one at a time to make sure that we work our way carefully through and we don't trip up. So item five, resolves to support 101 Lindsay Road working groups. We have Councillor Gottlieb who is moving that. Can I get a seconder, please? Councillor Connell, all those in favour?
Aye.
Those against? That is carried. Thank you. We're going to item 5A. Direct staff to enter negotiations with... I'm sorry?
One thing there. Now, we've taken out and commenced relevant process to turn into... plan into reserve, but I think that needs to be there because that's a long process. Been there, done that many years ago. It takes years.
Councillor Gottlieb, what we've heard from John is that there's concern that if we do that, then it removes the ability for council to work with the existing use, the contractors, and it removes that flexibility for us to do. To negotiate with the working group and to do what council needs to do. Have I got that right?
Yes, Your Worship, that is correct. The only, as I mentioned earlier, the only variation of that is if we declare the whole parcel as reserve. Mm. So it became local purpose, depot, community buildings, wellbeing hub, reserve.
And that's what it's going to be.
Yeah.
And that's why I think it would be nice to get the process underway.
And you could do that now if that was the will to do it, all of the parcel. My advocacy has been, no, define the bit for Community Marae and keep separate the depot portion. Because what it will give council is that some date in the future, and it may never happen, but it's just preserving options, that you could turn around and with a separate title deal with the depot portion independently of the other. At the moment, if once you've locked into making the whole thing reserve, even if your depot use disappears and goes, you're still going to be held as a reserve. So if you ever wanted to do anything with any of that land, other than for the local purpose that it's classified for, which can change over time, you have to go through the reserve revocation process. So it creates a future hurdle that you can actually mitigate at the front end. But it's a choice.
So Aileen's just made a suggestion that if we change that wording, and bearing in mind what Councillor Gottlieb has said, and the wording is changed to say that commences relevant process to turn a portion of the land into reserve, then that gives council the flexibility to define what we need and define what the community group needs, arrive at a consensus, and signal our intention of what we want to do. I know what Councillor Gottlieb has raised, and I agree with that. We've also, as a council, got to be mindful of the fact that we have signalled an intention with our chief executive to take back some ability for council to do in-house capability of works. If we're going to do that, we need the ability to have depots and access to council land for that purpose. And we don't want to lock ourselves out by closing the door at this stage.
Yeah, I'm happy with the proposed.
Thank you. Okay, so Councillor Rodley.
Yeah, so did Gary, what have we got on the table at the moment as far as...
So it's been right. Changed on, so item A commences relevant process to turn a portion of the land into reserve without defining what that is.
And Gary moved that? We,
yes.
Gary moved five. Item five.
Okay. Can I move, Chair, we don't have a mover or second.
Can I move
yet.
5A, please?
Okay, so we've got 5A on the table. We've got Councillor Rodley moving it. Can I get a seconder, please? Councillor Walker.
Can I ask a question?
Absolutely.
What costs are we incurring as we do this?
A piece of string.
Well, I need to know what I'm getting into, Gary. I mean, that's fine. If we're going to do it without doing it, I'll do it. You know, what sort of costs are involved in doing this?
I'm not sure that that's a fair question that the staff can answer on the fly, Councillor Morrissey. I understand we can't.
I think whatever it is, it's the best, isn't it? The best solution.
But I'm not convinced that that's a fair question for them to answer in today's environment. Okay, so can we just get the mover and the seconder sorted out? So we've got Councillor Rodley, Councillor Walker. All those in favour?
Aye.
Those against?
No.
So, okay. Thank you, Councillor Morrissey. Recorded?
Yeah, recorded.
Thank you. All right, that is carried. Thank you. We're going to go to 5B, request staff to engage with working group and report back to council on viable options.
Through the chair, we have put for the lease of part of the land.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Can I get a mover and a seconder for B, please? Councillor Sinclair, Councillor Walker, Councillor Gottlieb, could you turn off your mic, please? Councillor Grant, just before we vote on this, Councillor Grant, please.
Can I just raise a question in regard to the discussion that we've had around the time frame?
Mm-hmm.
Should we be putting something in here around a maximum time frame to complete this?
The fundraising?
Sorry, I totally support John, so it'd be interesting to know. I'm not asking for 1 year or 2 years or 3 years, just a time frame.
Give
me 8 years.
This will come back to council as there'll be stages in this. So there's no reason whatsoever. Staff have heard loud and clear that they want that to be part of the negotiations. This can come back to council and councillors can bring a proposed time frame back as part of the next stage of council resolutions in this. Are we okay to do that? Yep. Okay.
Would that actually be...
I don't see the need to do that today is what I'm saying, but it can be part of the next resolution that comes before council. Councillor Connell, please.
As part of that collaborative working relationship with the Whangamata Working Group, I would love to see just even a six-monthly update, because I think that's a good way to affi each other and to understand what sort of support you might need. Some of our financial people to give you some support or advice. So if they were in a cycle, then we would know that maybe funding wasn't going so well or as quickly as you'd expected before it became a thing. So I think, you know, having it, that regular catch-up report back to council would be really useful. That's
a very good idea. So why don't we include a request for the community group to report back to council in 6 months on their progress and also a proposed timeframe for the funding or fundraising efforts. Aileen, please.
If I could make a suggestion, there's two timeframes we need to think about. One is what's our period of negotiating the way forward, and then the second piece is how often are we going to hear about the funding. So I'd actually propose that not next council meeting, but the one after, staff report back around how the negotiations are shaping up and what that looks like and some of the detail that sits inside that. And thereafter, put a six. We'll talk to the group about what might be a relevant, because we don't want them doing a whole lot of work. So we'll work out what actually that might look like and bring that to council, and be it 6 monthly or 12 monthly or whatever it is. How does that sound?
I like it.
So if we report back in two meetings' time, with a whole package of how this is panning out and what that reporting might look like.
Do we need that to be a resolution, or it's just an action that the Chief Executive is going to take responsibility for?
It's just a good bureaucratic action just on behalf of the organisation.
I'm comfortable. All right. Okay. If we look at C, D and E, do we need those, or have we covered everything now? We don't need them, do we? John, anything in there?
Your Worship, not at this stage.
Okay.
They will have to come back once the parcels have been defined. Yep. I can see that might just take a little while to get there.
Okay. Okay. Robin?
Oh, no, I was just about to say, I think we've had a mover and a seconder for B, but we haven't done a vote yet.
Thank you. Okay, so B, we've got a mover and a seconder. I'll call for that. All those in favour, please.
Aye.
Those against? That is carried. On that basis, I'm going to declare item 2.1 settled. Thank you so much, councillors, for your really reasoned support. Thank you. Thank you, John. Thank you, Donna. Much appreciated.
I'd just like to say a quick thank you, if I can, through the councillors for your support for this. It's been a 10-year journey for me on my own. And I thank Ryan, Peter, Michelle and all the crew for all the efforts I put into this over the years. And we look forward to the journey ahead. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, councillor. And we will now take a break. Thank you.